Hi everyone, I'm Joshua Orro, the Mustang Prince, and welcome to Mustang Prince Orro Reports. Well, time for part 6 of my Halloween marathon of 2014. Now, in my eyes, Halloween isn't always about praising monsters. I find it as a time to face my fears. Like when times I usually watch horror films in order to do that. Like, also there are times when people learn to face fears after going through something truly traumatizing, like encountering a certain nightmare. I mean, like, does anyone get any dreams where you go on an epic adventure to a world where everything is filled with fun and laughter, and then later you go out there and learn to take responsibility and face something truly scary? Well, tonight's blog is actually an anime film from the early 90s, which is one example of facing your fears, plus learning from your mistakes. Released in Japan on July 15th, 1989, and in the United States on August 21st, 1992, the movie is Little Nemo Adventures in Slumberland. Now, let's start with the plot of this film. Warmly welcomed into the kingdom of Slumberland by King Morpheus himself, young Nemo is christened heir to the throne and given a magical key that will open any door in the kingdom. Though Nemo is warned not to open the one door with the power to destroy Slumberland, temptation proves too strong and the king is kidnapped as a dark cloud of nightmares washes over the formerly idyllic dreamscape. Now, if Nemo is to reverse his error and bring the king back alive, he must rally his friends and journey deep into Nightmare Land to face his ultimate fears. So, what did I think after seeing it for my first time years ago? Well, I thought it was really a great film, in my eyes. It was fun, dark, and it did have a good moral. And the music was very wonderful in the movie. But I think I should explain more information in my Mustang notes. Now, this movie is actually loosely based off the comic strip Little Nemo in Slumberland by Winsor McCay. The same man who gave us Dirty the Dinosaur. Nemo was the brainchild of producer Yutaka Fujioka. His dream for years had been to make a feature-length film and an animated version of Little Nemo, which would utilize the resources of his Tokyo Movie Shinsha Studio. As the first step towards realizing this project, in 1977, he personally flew to Montreal, California, to convince McKay's descendants to allow him to obtain the film rights to the comic strip. He originally approached George Lucas in a year later to help produce the film, but Lucas found problems with the storyline. Fujioka also approached Chuck Jones, but Jones also declined. The film was officially announced as a project in 1982. In February of that year, the company, TMS Kintographs, was formed in America to produce Nemo, and the best staff from all around the world were gathered together to begin production. Gary Kurtz was appointed producer of the American production side, and author Ray Bradbury, and later Edward Summer to write screenplays. Kurtz would eventually step down in the fall of 1984. In the early 80s, both Hayao Miyazaki and Isao Takahata were involved with the film, but they both left due to creative differences. Essentially, Miyazaki was not keen on the thought of an animated film created by him where everything was a dream, and Takahata was more interested in creating a story depicting Nemo's growth as a boy. Miyazaki later described his involvement on the film as the worst experience of his professional career. The directors who succeeded the duo were Andy Gaskill and Yoshifumi Kondo, whom both exited production in March 1985 after completing 70mm pilot film. Osamu Dezaki was also brought in to direct at a brief point and two completed a pilot film, but left as well. A third pilot was made by Sadao Tsuyoka and has yet to become publicly available. Then later, Brad Bird and Jerry Reese also worked on the film through the American Department as animators for a month. While at the time, we're also working on an up-produced adaptation of Will Eisner's The Spirit with Gary Kurtz. During production, the two would regularly ask animators what they were doing. The response they were commonly given was, "We're just illustrating what Bradbury is writing." Upon meeting Bradbury in person and asking him about the story he was writing for the film, he replied, "I'm just putting in writing what these wonderful artists are drawing." Bird and Reese soon left the project after the meeting with Bradbury. When all these people had left, Fujioka had drafts done by Chris Columbus, the guy who would later direct a few of the Harry Potter movies, and along with Mulvius and John Canemaker, and several others. He then rehired Summer to do yet another screenplay. Subsequently, Richard Oten were hired to work from Chris Columbus's screenplay. While Columbus was busy at his directorial debut, Adventures in Babysitting, many Disney studio animators, including Ken Anderson and Leo Salkin, worked on individual sequences, and John Canemaker, Courtney Cole, and Brian Froude provided visual development. Frank Thomas, Oliver Johnson, and Paul Gillian consulted into the production. Little production progress was made until January 1988, when the many ideas pasted on the walls of Los Angeles studios were whittled down in order to create the storyboard from which the film would be made. It was at this point that Frank and Ollie recommended William T. Hertz as the director of the American production side, and TMS hired Masami Hata, a former Sanrio film director, as the appointed director at TMS Studios in Japan. Actual animation for the completed film was commenced in June 1988, as TMS was just completed Akira, which was the Steamline dub, was also owned by Orion Pictures Corporation. The success of that film in Japan further helped TMS to start production on Little Nemo, even though it derived from the American comic strip. Little Nemo was animated by the Japanese company Tokyo Movie Shinsha, and thus is often considered an anime film. Even though it was a joint production of Japanese and American animators and production companies. And speaking of animation, while it's Japanese animated, I have no complaints to say about it. I mean, mostly everything in this film makes you feel like you're part of what's going on in Nemo's dreams. Like the scenes where Nemo's flying in his bed, the ending climax, and many other things as well. I also like how Slumberland and Nightmareland looks in this film. I mean, Slumberland looks like a colorful world filled with interesting shaped buildings, beautiful gardens, and friendly animals, as well as some circus-themed people around. Nightmareland, on the other hand, is more of a dark world, with a smelly swamp, a huge creepy forest infested with monsters and citizens, and Nightmare Castle looks like a huge mountain, while the inside looks like a dormant volcano, which is mostly pitch black. Now, While the background music was performed by the London Symphony Orchestra, the world-famous Sherman Brothers were hired to write the songs for Nemo. And just to let everyone know, this was the first anime film that they've worked in. Though, not their first animated film, though. I mean, they did work on several other projects for Disney in the past, including The Jungle Book and Hanna-Barbera Charlotte's Web. And also Snoopy Come Home as well, but I've already talked about that film anyway. Anyway, about the songs, I'll start with the opening song, Little Nemo, which is sung during the opening credits, and it does give a beautiful introduction for the movie. The final laughter song is sung while Camille shows Nemo and Icarus around Slumberland while having fun. And in my opinion, it's not that bad. I mean, I love that song. I mean, it does describe what Slumberland is as a fun place. And the rhythm of that song makes me think of that, well, makes me think of Call on Dolly from Hello Dolly. The etiquette song, where Nemo is being schooled by several teachers, is a bit weird. I mean, it starts off really simple with each lesson, like eating properly, dancing, fencing, book lessons, and riding a horse, but then when the song is about to finish, it goes to a fast pace, which makes me kind of dizzy. The Boomp song, that's sung by the newly supporting characters, known as the Boomps, is kind of a nice song too. But kind of a bit too short as well. I mean, it describes what they are and what they do. And they do mention that one of them was left behind at Nightmare Castle during the song. And the ending song, Slumberland, which is, well, it is kind of sung more than once, but that's beside the point. It does sound almost like a lullaby in a way. Now, I think it's time for me to talk about the English cast for this movie. Now, Nemo is voiced by Gabriel Damon, who prior to this film voiced Littlefoot in Don Bluth, The Land Before Time. Nemo is like a little boy living in 1905 New York City. He's like lives on like old vehicle models like trains, planes, and blimps. I mean, he's taken to Slumberland to be the official playmate to Princess Camille and be the heir to the elderly King Morpheus. I like this character. I mean, sure, Nemo does get into some trouble a few times, but as the movie goes on, Nemo does learn from his mistakes and takes responsibility for them as well, in order to face certain danger. Next we have Icarus, a flying squirrel voiced by Danny Mann, who I know as Ferdinand from Babe, and recently voiced Sparky in the Planes movies. Now, Icarus is Nemo's only friend from the real world. He does show great concern for Nemo's well-being, in a sense similar to that of two siblings. He does speak in a bit of a mix of both squirrel and some English. I mean, kind of like a Boo from Aladdin, in a way. And his screech is kind of painful to the Boomps as well. Plus, he detests being called a rat. Unlike other squirrels, Icarus eats human food, like cookies, for example. And his initial relationship with Princess Camille, though rough, eventually changes for the better as well. Next we have Professor Genius, who is voiced by Rena Bojoyes, who I know was in films like Cats Don't Dance, The Little Mermaid, and Hayao Miyazaki's The Cat Returns. He's King Morpheus' advisor and a supporting protagonist for the film. He comes to the real world to bring Nemo to Slumberland, and he's a sophisticated man. I mean, he's quite punctual and prefers order as opposed to madness. And he's quite a dancer as well. I mean, he does dance quite a bit during Nemo's coronation ceremony. In the real world, he's an organ player in a circus that stops by New York. Next we have Princess Camille, who is voiced by Laura Mooney. Though she initially acts somewhat spoiled, she eventually grows to like Nemo. She also grows fond of Icarus, and vice versa, despite a rough start, anyway. When her father is kidnapped by the Nightmare King, she takes over as ruler and decides to join Nemo in his quest to save King Morpheus. In the real world, she is the ringmaster's daughter at the circus. Plus, I like Camille. I mean, sure, she, like, I already mentioned that she acts kind of a little spoiled and bratty a little bit, but overall, she's a really sweet character, and plus, I think she's kind of cute. But my favorite character in this film, by far, is Flip, who's unfortunately voiced by the late Mickey Rooney.
Why do you have to die?
For those who don't know about him, he voiced in a few of the Rankin Bass holiday specials. Anyway, Flip is described as a frightful fellow. He is wanted throughout Slumberland for having fun. The bounty of his head is like a sizable one. And his only friend is his partner in crime, which is an oversized bird named Flap. He tricks Nemo into accidentally releasing the Nightmare King and blames him for the ruin of Slumberland. He's in the possession of a map of Nightmare Land, which is, well, hand-drawn and written in his own unreadable special super code. He does serve as the guide to the Nightmare Castle until he's replaced by the Boomps. And he has a serious smoking addiction, and thank God I don't smoke, ever. In the real world, he's like a clown who bumps into Nemo while keeping his balance on a ball at the circus. Next we have King Morpheus, the elderly ruler of Slumberland, who is voiced by Bernard Erhard. He has protected Slumberland for several years, with the help of the Royal Scepter, which is an ancient weapon of great power. Though he's a child at heart, he knows when to be serious. He was the one who brought Nemo to Slumberland so that he may become his heir to the throne. And I already mentioned that Morpheus gave Nemo the key to Slumberland, which can open any door, and warns him about the door with the dragon symbol on it. But, like Professor Genius, he is quite a dancer and, well, dances alongside him as well during Nemo's coronation. But when Nemo accidentally releases the king and Morpheus is captured, Nemo must do what's right and go out to Nightmare Land to save him. In the real world, he's the ringmaster of the circus. Could it be that this film is kind of like Alice in Wonderland or Wizard of Oz or Peter Pan in a way? Because, like, everyone that Nemo meets in Slumberland is kind of related to who he sees in New York? Maybe. And now the character I want to talk about right now is the Nightmare King, who is voiced by Bill Martin. This is he's like a demonic creature who's locked behind the massive door until he is accidentally set free by Nemo, who is given the key to the door by King Morpheus. Once he's released, he captures Morpheus as revenge for his imprisonment, and then retreats back to Nightmare Castle. In my eyes, he's kind of like a mix of Chernabog from Fantasia, the Dark Side from the Kingdom Hearts games, and surprisingly, the Shadow Blob from Epic Mickey. When Nemo goes to the castle to save King Morpheus, the Nightmare King has his winged minions try to capture Nemo's friends. That scene almost makes me think of the flying monkey ambush from The Wizard of Oz. Anyway, the Nightmare King is shown quite temperamental as he destroys several of his minions for failure of one of his underlings. The only thing that can defeat him is a legendary royal scepter, which is almost exactly like a keyblade in a way. And lastly, we have the Boomps. Oompa, voiced by Neil Ross. Oomph, voiced by Alan Oppenheimer. Oompo, voiced by John Stevenson. Oompay, voiced by Sidney Miller, and Oompy, voiced by Michael Bell. These guys are really great supporting characters. They are the only residents of Nightmareland who can't terrify anybody. But what's cool about them is their teamwork and combining with each other to make one massive shape. Now, time to move on to my final words of this movie. Above all, Little Nemo is an outstanding film. It has enchanting and magnificent animation, and it's also really imaginative. There are some dark and scary parts of this film, and like I said before, this movie does have a good moral of keeping promises, learning from your mistakes, and facing your fears. I give this film a 97%. Well, that's all for tonight. Be sure to join me next time for my last Halloween blog of 2014. Because in that one, that's when I'll be taking you down Elm Street. Mustang Power.
Welcome to Slumberland, joys without numberland, rainbows end. Kingdom of dreamy time, starbeams and valentines, where everyone is a friend. This is where sad hearts are mended, where happy endings begin. So welcome to Slumberland, joys without numberland. Come.